For the goal of relating science to people, we look for science enthusiasts who are willing to take on the challenge and test their knowledge in our biological world. Witness who among the challengers will come on top. This is Name That Science, Flora Edition. Let's meet our challengers. Are you ready? Let's take a look on the first question. What commonality is or are there between these two elements that makes it harmful and at the same time present on Earth's surface? Challengers, please key in your answer. The correct answer is...
Atmospheric nitrogen and sulfur dioxide are both present in the atmosphere, which contributes to the creation of acid rain. When acid rain happens, it causes imbalance in nutrient concentration in the Earth's soil and disrupts the pH level or acidity level of aquatic ecosystems, leading to the death of different organisms.
Hope that helps well. Challengers, let's look at the second question. Both nitrogen and sulfur are elements that constitutes acid rain. It is known that acid rain is a harmful natural occurrence. In terms of elemental importance, which do you think among the two is more important for plants' growth? Let's see who got the correct answer.
Both elements are largely important in plants' growth. Nitrogen is responsible for the plants to make proteins that will make plants help to grow. In a relatable sense, nitrogen is the foundation for a high corn yield. However, when there is an abundance of nitrogen absorbed by the plants, it results to excessive biomass. The plant may seem to be healthy because it has many stalks and leaves, but its roots are very malnourished. There is not much nitrogen present, the plant will not grow properly. To balance the nitrogen content of soil, that is when sulfur comes in. Sulfur produces lignin and pectin, which are organic compounds that aid plant growth. Sulfur contributes to chlorophyll production. Most importantly, sulfur metabolizes nitrogen. Through nitrogen and sulfur cycle, the elements are deposited into the soil and converted into consumable organic compounds, which are then absorbed and used by plants.
Challengers, here's your next question. By what percent do fossil fuels contribute to energy generation based on the statistics of the U.S. Energy Information Administration? Explainer?
There is approximately 63% of energy generated from fossil fuels just last year. On the other hand, only 20% of generated energy accounts from nuclear energy, and the other 18% are from renewable resources. Honestly, fossil fuels are good energy sources. However, the downside for fossil fuels is that it kills the environment rapidly. The burning of fossil fuels to generate usable energy that releases massive carbon and other gaseous pollutants that destroy our planet's protective layer, the ozone layer. It also disrupts the nitrogen and sulfur cycle. At the same time, these gases substances triggers acid rain. When acid rain occurs, the acidity of lakes and the Earth's soil is affected. This causes imbalance in the ecosystem. The more acidic the soil becomes, the less fertile it gets. This then gives plants stress. Aside from fossil fuel combustion, production and use of nitrogen-rich fertilizers adds stress to the environment, as well as release of smoke from automobiles destroys the natural cycles.
This round goes to Challenger 3. Let's move on to the fourth question. According to the National Strategy for Invasive Plant Management, invasive plants have already occupied more than 100 million acres in the U.S. In this case, how many acres are lost to invasive plants every year? Please show us the answer.
Every year, there are almost 3 million acres of land in the U.S. that are lost to invasive plant species. That costs over 4,600 acres of land that are lost every day due to invasive plant species. But what exactly are these invasive plant species? Invasive plant species are the non-native species in the ecosystem that are introduced by either intentional or unintentional activity or throwing leftover seeds over the road. These are species that causes harm to the existing ecosystem they are brought in. The most popular invasive plant known to many is the kudzu plant in the southern United States. It can grow up to 1 foot per day and is popular for eating up an entire house. I mean literally covering up an entire house. It originally came from Japan and was planted widely in the 1930s as a solution to soil erosion and nutrient-poor soil. However, it became an eerie plant to many.
Congratulations, Challenger 1. You are now the lead of the game. Alright, we are down to our last question. And whoever may get this question correct will be our winner. What is the simplest analogy that can instantly distinguish epigenetics from genetics? Explainer?
Epigenetics is the study of changes in the organism caused by changes in the gene expression without any modification in the genetic code of the organisms. This opens the understanding that it's naturally possible for organisms to exhibit difference with each other. Such changes are brought about by factors which triggers the organism's genetic makeup to act accordingly to what the situation dictates. This is possible because of the proteins present in the DNA that is responsible for turning on and off functions that allow unique characteristics in some organisms. Put it simply, epigenetics is responsible for the numerous body cells in humans, animals, and plants to be different with each other. Brains, lungs, and the heart are all made up of the same body cells, but proteins in each of these cells turn on and off to specify the true function of that organ. Call these on and off switches as epigenetic tags. In plants, it is observed in the behavior of the Mimosa pudica. When a person touches a Mimosa pudica, it automatically reacts by closing together its leaves. However, when the same person touches the plant several times, it will display no reactions as it seems like the plant has recognized the person. As the plant develops its upstream, their behavior remains in the upstream. Such behavior is explained by the epigenetics. The genetic makeup of the plants remains the same, but the change in the organic expression that occurred to the parent plant is carried on in its offspring. This is possible because of epigenetics. Most importantly, scientists and agricultural experts saw a lot of potential in epigenetics in terms of increasing reproduction and quality without resorting to extreme artificial genetic modification.
Congratulations, Challenger 3, for being the winner of today's episode. Everyone, thank you for staying with us. We will come back with more exciting episodes and knowledge to share with everyone. For the last time, this is Name That Science.